consider subscribing, perhaps.
And I want to go ahead and apologize to you guys in advance. I'm just going to let you know this. If you hang out to the end, I have a little treat for you.
Anyway, let's get to it.
Air right there. So what's up, guys? It's Corey here. Right here at City Hall. We got fire rescue pulling in. Got a commission meeting that I'm gonna be filming here. I'm gonna go full 360 when we get inside.
Yeah, don't mind me. I'm going to be here, like, hanging out and interjecting because it's going to get pretty freaking boring. I was bored when I was there. But you'll get to see what the city decided on when it comes to, you know, our safety.
Stand here and get some shots. Everybody! Deputy Chief, I believe. See anybody masked up, so I'm not really gonna worry about that.
They're using this big old building today.
Good, how are you?
Yeah, so I just did my first pickup order at Walmart, and disinfectant wipes were still sold out, so.
Question number one, is the city of Winter Haven formally encouraging or formally mandating members of the public to wear cloth, fabric, face masks when out in the public and shopping at essential businesses such as pharmacies, groceries, fast food restaurants, etc., etc.? I guess I'll call the city attorney to answer that question.
I believe that we did. Chief Berg responded to that email or something with his office, but my understanding is that we are encouraging people to wear face masks out in public, both in accordance with guidance from the CDC and the Department of Health. I don't know if we're mandating anyone to do that, but we are certainly encouraging people to do that.
City manager has the data.
The mayor, city commissioners, they are on our city website. We have a message from the city of Winter Haven. We have designed this in a way of frequently asked questions. I've shared this information with you. This was prepared by Don Sheehan, assistant to the city manager. This is also going to be here in our utility bills as a bill stopper. And so, the point that you raised or the citizen raised, wear a face mask if you're sick or if you're not. And so, we are encouraging people to do so along with self-isolating and, of course, to stay away from others if you have been infected. So, the answer is yes.
Okay, so Mr. Jones' question, answer number one is yes, we are formally encouraging this face mask. Question number two, is the city Winter Haven formally encouraging or formally mandating employees of essential businesses to wear cloth, fabric masks when serving or working at essential businesses such as pharmacies, groceries, fast food restaurants, etc., etc.?
Well, the guidelines from the Center for Disease Control and in watching the news conferences over the weekend that were conducted by the President of the United States and other members of his team, the masks are voluntary, they're not mandatory, but they're highly suggested. And so I think the answer would be yes. We're encouraging businesses to do so, individuals to do so, relative to the chamber is, put that out in their messages to the chamber members. And so we would say pay attention to the Center for Disease Control, wear masks.
Thank you. I think that would be considered formally encouraging, so that's good. Third question, what is the Winter Haven Public Safety Director doing to make Winter Haven residents safer in this COVID-19 crisis? Chief, is that you? Or?
Is that the last question?
Yes, that's the last question of the email.
All right, then I think it's appropriate to turn to Public Safety Director Berg. The first item of your presentation this evening is to give an update with respect to COVID-19 strategies that we have put into place along with that, City Attorney will be giving you an overview of the Governor's Executive Order 20-91. The Public Safety Director Berg will be talking about our enforcement strategies with respect to complying with the Executive Order 20-91, and he will address Mr. Jones' question as well. I'll yield the Public Safety Director Berg.
Okay, Chief.
Honorable Mayor, City Commissioners, what I'd like to do, what I was going to do is before I get into the meat of what I'm going to present to you, I wanted the Deputy Fire Chief to give you an update on the COVID numbers and everything, the most recent thing that he has.
Commissioner Mayor, currently Polk County has 157 positive cases as of 11 o'clock today. State of Florida has 13,324. Death rate in Florida is at 236. Our local death rate in Polk County is 4 at this current time from COVID-19 virus.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Judge, the answer to Mr. Jones' question is pretty voluminous. I'm going to go through my presentation because I'll answer some of those things, and then I'll hit on some other as far as what we're doing to try to keep folks safe. First and foremost, one of the things that we're concentrating on is making sure that our workforce is safe and protected against being exposed, dealing with the exposures to minimize or mitigate those exposures, and then also if there's an exposure, to get them isolated as quickly as possible so that we don't contaminate other employees. One of the first things for public safety that we have to do in order to be able to provide public safety is provide the employees that can do that public safety. And if they're sick and we lose a great deal due to having to self-quarantine or isolate, then we don't have the workforce to be able to go out and provide public safety. So that's the number one thing that we're trying to do to provide public safety. The Department of Public Safety team has so far done an exceptional job with the current COVID crisis. Your first responders will continue to answer all the calls for service, provide medical treatment, fight crime, educate, and correct anyone that may be in violation of any of the emergency orders issued by Governor DeSantis today. As I'm sure you're aware, there have been quite a few questions dealing with Executive Order 20-91, which was issued April 1st and went into effect last Friday, April 3rd. This emergency order will remain in effect until April 30th at a minimum, and as previously stated, in violation of emergency order is also a violation of Florida State Statute, which is a second-degree misdemeanor. It can be punishable under Florida State Statute 775.082, 775.083, which is up to a $500 fine and prison in imprisonment not to exceed 60 days. So what does enforcement look like? Enforcement looks like these are the protocols that we're doing for the enforcement. We've identified the most likely violations that people expect to see as being non-essential businesses being in operation when they shouldn't be, people gathering in public places in numbers greater than 10, and people gathering in private residences in numbers greater than 10. We've actually had a few calls for that at some other local jurisdictions. So our procedure, how are we going to approach that? How are we going to go about enforcing this? Well, the number one goal is to educate the potential violator. What we want to do is bring them into compliance themselves. Sometimes I hate to say that somebody doesn't know, especially if they're paying attention and knows what's going on, they should know. What we want to do is educate them and make sure that they understand what they're up against and what the dangers are for them violating that order. What we want to do is we want to bend over backwards to try to make sure that we have people that will follow those orders as they're given. So one of the procedures that we put in place to observe violations is to our officers. If they observe a violation or receive a call for service, the supervisor will respond along with them to help evaluate. Persons in a public place shall be in a violation. If the violator is a person or a group of persons, we'll make contact with each of them, explain to them what the violation is under the emergency order, so they understand clearly what the violation is, and provide them a warning to bring them into compliance. At that point in time, we expect that they would comply. If this is occurring on city property, we can consider, we can consider a trespass as well. If the preferred person refused to disperse, then we would issue a trespass warning. If the person still refused to disperse, the subject may be arrested for trespassing, citing the Executive Order 20-91 as trespass. That's the executive order, but there would be a criminal case under the 4-state statute for violating trespass after being issued. Business violations, we're to seek out the person in charge of the business at the time and explain the operation to their business as a violation of the emergency order. Approve this history as we do this so that we can make sure that whether we can identify repeat offenders or not. If it's somebody that's continually trying, it'll be entered into our CAD system under comments so that we can then pull that back up to it so that we can say, okay, listen, this is your second offense. This is the second time you've done this. We've already warned you. We've already given you the information that you need. We need you to come in compliance. We advise them that we'll be documenting that warning, and the violation as well as the fact that they were provided with the warning will be reported. If businesses receive prior warnings and found the main violation the second time, issue the appropriate person a second documented warning, and then advising that further violations may result in a criminal charge, which is a second degree misdemeanor. Again, it's documented in our CAD system, and if we find them in violation a third time, and third violation, especially if it's within 48 hours of the second violation, they will be criminally charged. Not arrested, they'll be charged through affidavit. And I'll comment on that in just a minute. Any notice to appear issued shall be forwarded to the Uniform Services Captain for review to make sure all the steps were handled and that the supervisor was there if possible. If the third violation was not within 48 hours of the second violation, then it will be documented with a warning again to get the time the clock started again. If a fourth violation occurs, they'll be charged and possibly a physical arrest could take place. Now understand something, that's our last, absolute last alternative that we want to get to. We want to get compliance. We're taking the same approach as the sheriff is and every other jurisdiction in the county. We want to do it, but as the sheriff pointed out, in his address to the county commissioners on Friday, there is not enough room in the jail to put over 600,000 people that have been outside to violate. There's no room in the jail to put over 40,000 of Winter Haven residents in there. There's just simply not room. The goal is to get compliance. But if you have someone that pushes the issue, that continues to be a problem, it's gonna push it, then we will do what we have to do and take the action that we need to take. And if that includes arrest, then that would be it. The 911 call center, who dispatches for Winter Haven, has protocols in place for first responders to try to screen the calls for any signs or symptoms of COVID-19 in an effort to prepare first responders for potential exposure prior to arriving at the scene. Cooperation is essential during this period of time. We need the public to cooperate. That's the message that we have to keep drilling out there and that we actually do. The public needs the police themselves. Again, we will work diligently to correct, to educate, but if we have someone charge that may go with it. I say may. It all depends on how that encounter goes. But it's, again, we want to push that. We want self-compliance. We want people to comply with this. So to give you an update about the Department of Public Safety, some of the efforts that we've taken include continued monitoring of our employees prior to work and every 12 hours afterwards. It includes taking the temperature, it includes the visual signs, checking for cough, sneezing, shortness of breath, those types of things. If any of those markers are identified, we have two captains, the EMS captain in the fire department and the training captain for both medics, who will come in and do an evaluation on the employee. And if they make the determination whether or not they need to go home or if they can stay if they meet the criteria. If an employee has to be isolated, they will continue to be monitored in that way so that the first time the signs of COVID-19 or the signs start coming up, they'll immediately be taken to a facility so that they can be treated. One of the options that we had, too, for our first responders is trying to set up if any of them did not want to go home and risk the possibility of contaminating their loved one or family member. We have a location.
Did he just literally eat shit?
That we will put them at if they want to voluntarily go there. It's provisioned with sleeping. It's got showers, bathrooms, a kitchen, everything that they need, and it's pretty isolated. It probably sits on 2 acres of land. Staffing in the fire department is being divided, so only one engine company will be staffed at station one. We're in the process of identifying two off-site locations because we don't want. We have one firefighter at station one that becomes COVID positive, and that's where the majority, we have actually three engine companies that respond out of station one. If they go in, we have the potential to lose 45 firefighters at one time. So we are now separating that out so that we have basically operating a mini station in different locations so that they won't, that chance reduces and we can minimize the possibility of spreading that. Finally, I just want to speak on social distancing. We need to use good personal hygiene. As prescribed by the CDC. If you go into one of the essential businesses that you're going to go to, the CDC recommends wearing cloth-based coverings in public settings. This is answering that question, one of the emails that you got. If you go into a public setting where social distancing is impossible, quite frankly, if you go to the grocery store, people get piled up pretty quickly. So you have to be mindful of that, be willing to say something. And that's where the CDC is recommending these masks would be useful. For our first responders, encountering people, those masks are not sufficient, any N95 masks, to be able to protect our first responders. Again, I stress all the rules. This is a scary crisis, and people are afraid. We need to stay calm, we need to stay vigilant, we need to provide leadership during this time, because we will come through this. I want to encourage that there is hope and look at this in a positive way. Before there were cell phones, before there were computers and the internet, I remember it. There was family game night. There was reading books. There was watching TV with your family. There was going outside and taking walks. There's many things that we need to focus on for people to do, because if you sit at home and just watch the news, it's not a good, there's nothing good that comes out of that. It's going to depress you. It's going to cause you a great bit of consternation. And you're going to lose hope. And right now, just as important is people's mental awareness. And again, I want to focus on learn to be a family again. Let's do the things that we used to do before cell phones and the internet and computers came into play. Go back to building those relationships. And together we'll get through this. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them. You may have any. I'll do the best I can.
Thanks, Chief. I think you did a good job of answering no questions anyway, so now I'll ask my fellow commissioners if they have any questions for the chief.
please be truthful because it matters. Be truthful because that's how they get equipped. You know, the difference between police and fire, I say we have the same mission, but how we go about those missions are a little bit different. And in law enforcement, we don't always have the ability to, you know, someone calls 911 and says, my house is being broken into, we can't say, okay, before we get into that, do you have a cough? Do you have temperature? So that part of it is going to, that's a risk that's going to be there. The officers, when they get out, and because crime is still occurring, the criminals aren't taking a break, they don't seem to be afraid of COVID. So our officers are still continuing to go out there and provide the services to protect our public and our property. So they will bond us with that equipment, that PPE equipment as well. They've been trained on it because some of the gowns and all, we never trained how to get that off without being recontaminated. We've done that training. The officers haven't had to use that very often. Usually it's blood when they use that. Now it's completely different. So we do have the equipment. They are using it. We're putting in, actually today, the Chief Brandon and I talked about when they should be using the N95 mask on certain calls and prioritizing it in certain situations, which we've done. So as we identify those things, then we make it a priority that they have to follow that protocol. But again, we have to, you know, we have to reuse the mask sometimes. We have to do it until we can get some more product in. The officers are taking the necessary steps. We're drilling that into them to continue. You don't have to go rushing into a house. You can ask them to come out, especially if it's a worker recall or something like that. You don't need to go run into the house. Talk to them from a distance. We have that online reporting that we also implemented. That seems to be catching on very well. And that mitigates or minimizes the contact that those officers have. So it's kind of a broad answer to your question because there's no set, you know, depending on the circumstances, if they jump out and try to, you know, because there's a fight they got to deal with or somebody's getting stabbed or something like that, they're gonna run into it. That's kind of what we're training for. When we raised our right hand and took the oath to serve and protect, that's kind of what we signed up for. But we're doing everything we can to protect our our members. Yes, sir.
Any else? Chief, I got a question about has to do with mask. I was asked today by a local business, they're deemed an essential business, and they can't find masks. Their employees, they've got 10 employees. Is there any place you can suggest they go to get masks or find them?
For the N95s?
He didn't get that specific. He just needs something for his warehouse.
I don't know because we're concentrating so much on our N95s for our first responders. I don't have a good answer for that. But with what the CDC, the reason the CDC said that the cloth masks are helpful in situations, not so much that it keeps that's what the N95 mask does, it keeps the virus out of your mask. Cloth won't keep it out of your mask, but what it does is it works as if you're using a handkerchief or something to sneeze, cough into it. Our carrier, then it's not spewing out those particles and landing on surfaces that can then contaminate other people. And and in that regard, you can make those types of masks. I know there's a lot of people that are self-making them. Does anybody else?
Mr. Mayor, I'll chime in on that. Okay. The N95s are like liquid gold right now. It's the number one supply request that we're getting through the EOC statewide. And as Chief said, they're the most protective thing in our first responders in our medical community can have, and in all reality, that's where those need to be deployed to. There are a lot of our vendors that are out there that are doing uniform materials and apparel have available the cloth-style masks that Chief Bird is referencing, and I would suggest to anybody that they're a business that procures uniform apparel or any of the kind of logo apparel that they reach out to their vendor for that, and they can probably find a product that will meet their needs. We were able to do that last week with our city employees to try and create an added level of protection for our folks in utilities and public works, parks and rec and such, without having to jeopardize the supply of N95s.
Okay. Anybody else?
Okay, Chief. Anything else? One other thing I do want to say is that we have had, we're not without, some exposures or possible exposures. I think we've got six, seven
firefighters right now.
Seven firefighters that have been potentially exposed. Self-isolating, and you know, it's a scary thing that they've had the first firefighter in Polk County, and there's been more that tested positive for COVID. So as this thing grows, we're going to
the order is obviously, as everyone is aware of that, is the stay at home, the safer at home order that we had been contemplating or expecting from the issue. The governor's exercise or issuance of this order was constituted his constitutional and his statutory authority. So therefore, I would view this, like the court would as well, as statutory law for purposes of enforcement and reporting or construction. That has a legal meaning to me, but the gist of it is, this is the law. Right now, during the effective date of this order goes for 30 days through the end of the month. The order is addressed to a few core things. It identifies senior citizens and individuals who are at significant potential underlying medical conditions. That's not defined specifically, but there are a number of conditions that are listed in the order, such as chronic lung disease, moderate to severe asthma, serious heart condition, immunocompromised status, cancer, diabetes, severe obesity, renal failure, and liver disease, among others. What the order does, it tells us, and particularly those of us in the community who are vulnerable.
If you haven't noticed already, this video is boring as hell, so I'm probably gonna put this clip in there, and I'm putting a bunch of extra B-roll footage over the audio of the meeting. So, but yeah, that's what's going on. I can't do it to myself anymore. I certainly can't do it to you guys anymore. They're just going to talk about closing the parks and boat ramps and stuff like that. They'll give you an example of their idea for the sign to let the public know that it's closed. I think there's a little bit more scenery. I talked to the deputy chief briefly, and then on to your treat. That's on the emails all the time talking to you.
I figured that was you.
Okay. Yeah. How's everything been going with all this so far for you guys?
Well, not bad.
Yeah. With this park stuff, that's not going to include any public sidewalks around the park and stuff. It's just actually in the park, right?
From my understanding, and that I have that posted,
it
should just be in
the parks. Gotcha. All right, man. Stay healthy. You too. All right, how are you? I hear you, man. Hey, does Vanessa Castillo not work for the city anymore? Sir? Does Vanessa Castillo work for you guys? She's been out? Okay.